The next one is just 30 seconds because we're about 15 minutes behind.
Nobody smoke weed. Have coffee. And there's a little alcohol, you know, for those.
Don, you ready? All right, well, welcome back. This is going to be the campaign 101, section. And in your packets on the second page starts an FAQ for candidates that's about 4 pages long. I'm not going to cover all of it, but it's here for you to reference. And we're just going to go over some of the main points. I know probably at least a third of you have been candidates already, so some of this is probably familiar territory. But in general, so in order to be a candidate in the state of Texas, you have to file an application with the appropriate election authority and appoint a campaign treasurer with the appropriate election authority, So the appropriate authorities are: for nonpartisan races for like city council, you file it with the city clerk. For water boards, you file it with the water board secretary. For school boards, you file it with the school board secretary. And getting that information can be a little tedious and time consuming and sometimes impossible to get. And that's obviously by design. But for partisan races, it's pretty straightforward. You file, if it's a county level seat, like county commissioner, county judge, anything that's solely within that county border boundary lines, including like justice of the peace, all of that, you file with the county chair of the political party. So whoever your county chairs are, you would file the application with them. The application is actually in your packet just after the FAQ. It looks like this: application for nomination by blank convention of blank. And so it would be by county convention, district convention, state convention of Green Party. It's actually more clear in the Spanish version, so you know what the boxes are. But so you have to fill this out, get it notarized. And for partisan races, the filing deadline is going to be November, is it 11th? Oh, it's not on here. I think it's November 11th to December 11th or somewhere around there. And if you want to run for like state rep, US Congress, governor, any statewide of seats, Criminal Court of Appeals Justice, Supreme Court Justice, Railroad Commissioner, all of those seats get filed with the state co-chairs of the party. You do not have to turn anything into a government agency, because the party has to take all of those applications, put it into a format required by the Secretary of State, and then give them that information. So as a partisan candidate, which means you only have ballot access if we get ballot access, you have to file with the county chairs or the state chairs, depending on which race you're running for. Does anybody have any questions about that? Is that pretty clear? Okay. The campaign treasurer, so according to the rules in Texas, once you file this application, you are officially a candidate and you are required to file a campaign treasurer appointment immediately with the Texas Ethics Commission. If you're running for state rep or above, statewide seats or state rep. If you're running for Congress, whole different story, and I'll get back to that. If you're running for Justice of the Peace or Sheriff or County Commissioner, those campaign treasurer appointments get filed with the local filing authority. So it's probably going to be the county clerk. Most large cities, it's the county clerk. Sometimes there's like a special person we give it to at the elections office. So you just have to call the elections office and say, who do I file my campaign treasurer report to with? And they will tell you, hopefully. And then you follow that with that person. If you do not file it right away, they can fine you, but as long as you don't accept or raise, if you don't take any money or spend any money, even your own personal money, if you spend your own personal money, you have to have a campaign treasurer report, appointment on file, okay? If you do not, you can get in trouble and it will cost you money. So just file it right away. You do this one, do your campaign treasurer at the same time, file them both, and then you don't have to worry about it. Now in Texas, the candidate is ultimately responsible for the financial reporting, regardless of whether or not you appoint somebody else as a treasurer. So you are actually allowed in Texas to be your own campaign treasurer. I do not advise it unless you cannot find a trustworthy person, because it's tedious, time consuming. However, I've done it for all of my own campaigns. So it is legal. It is possible. I did get harassed for it. Somebody sent me a postcard in the mail telling me that I was violating ethics by being my own campaign treasurer, but it's actually legal. So, and you're ultimately responsible. So if you don't have a trustworthy person and you're running a really small campaign, then go ahead and do it yourself. But it's really gonna eat up a lot of your time that you could be doing something else. Does anybody have any questions about that? You don't have to have a bank account open to file your campaign treasurer appointment form. It's called a CTA on the Ethics Commission website. The form is called CTA form, campaign treasurer appointment. And it's the same form, you just file it with different people. So the filing period again is mid-November to mid-December of the year prior to the election. So this year we would file for the 2018 general, actually it's for the 2018, it's not general election technically, but yes. It's gonna be for the convention process, right? You're applying to be on the convention ballot. You're not applying to be on the general ballot. If you file, independents have to file at the same time as party files, and I'm not sure, we need to get this clarified, but because we don't have ballot access, I'm not sure if you can file both as an independent and as, did we clarify this?
The
go ahead.
Code says that they can't, an independent candidate can't be affiliated with the party, which for our purposes would mean that they couldn't actually vote in the convention. So since that's the only way that Texas, you know, legally affiliates an individual with the party.
Right, but if we don't get ballot access, then we're not a party and that's irrelevant.
Right, but that happens after the filing deadline. So it seems to me at the beginning that if they filed with the party, then they would be affiliated with the party. So it seems to me to be an either or.
No. This application does not affiliate you with the party. Attending the precinct convention affiliates you with the party. So since we don't know if we're going to have ballot access, it would be worth filing both an independent application with the Secretary of State, because that's who I think it goes to, unless it's a local race, and filing with the party. That way, if we don't get ballot access, you can still run as an independent. But then you wouldn't be able to participate in the precinct convention process or sign the petition. So that's a more complicated issue we'll get back to. So then, so what this gives you is the right to be on the Green Party's ballot in the precinct convention process, which is our mimicking of the primary since we're not allowed to have primaries, right? So anybody who files an application to be on the ballot will go on the precinct convention ballots that'll be all over the state, and then, and none of, and everybody has to run against none of the above in the Green Party. So if you're the only person that files and you're not a Green and you're local or whoever's voting and that knows that you're not and doesn't vote and votes for none of the above, you will not be on the general ballot, right? But if you beat none of the above in your election, in the precinct convention elections, then you'll be on the general election ballot. Does that make sense? Any questions? Okay. So, campaign basics. First off, read the book. This is the Campaign Manager by Catherine Shaw. This is the book that John Eder, who was the first elected Green to a state legislature, recommended when I went to his campaign 101 workshops. And it is extremely informative and clear and step-by-step how to put yourself together, how to put your campaign together, and how to win an election. And the honestly, I haven't read this in a decade, but the things that have really stuck with me are that never say your opponent's name because you are giving them free publicity. Refer to them as your opponent or some other way to refer to them that's not derogatory. And have your three main points, right? There's 10 billion issues, but you have to have your three main things that are your constant talking points because you have to drill people and they can't retain more than that. And then when you have your one-on-one conversations or other questions come up, you're gonna have to be prepared for that as well, but you have to come up with your three main points. And those are the two big ones. But you need to set up your campaign so that people can find you, get a hold of you, contact you through multiple means. And if you can't keep track of every social media outlet, you can have a presence there directing them back to your website, directing them back to whatever main form of communication your campaign is using. And just tell people, this is, I have this here, but we post everything over here, so go find me over here. And you want to have some organizations will do candidate forums, they'll send out questionnaires, so you've got to have a way for them to contact you. And I will tell you, over the last 17 years, it started out with mail, like people would just get the addresses from the Secretary of State and mail everybody things. But now it's all email. Like in the last election cycle, we got tons of people asking us for email contacts for candidates who weren't really running campaigns, so they didn't really have a campaign set up. But these groups were trying to get them to come to events and things like that. So you can set up a separate email on any free service. And you can, you know, all of this stuff you can do for free, but it's better if you can, like, set up a real website, set up a real email with your own domain name, stuff like that, so it looks more professional. But there are tons of candidates who use Gmail and stuff like that. The financial reporting requirements are extremely important because you will get fined unless you file a waiver. I've successfully filed a waiver, and I know another candidate successfully filed a waiver for the fees. Like, if you get a fee for filing something late and you have a good excuse, you file a waiver, and they usually give it to you. Especially if you're not talking a lot about a lot of money here, right? If you're just running a $500 or less campaign, the reporting requirements are very minimal. You will have to fill out a personal financial statement with the Texas Ethics Commission by late January of 2018. You will have to everybody, I think everybody has to do that except for federal candidates. Federal candidates are a whole different thing. So if you're talking about Congress, this is not applicable to you. When you file your CTA, you indicate that you're planning on raising and spending less than $500, you have a different reporting requirements, and then you're only required to report January 15th and July 15th. And then your final report if you close your campaign down. If you don't close your campaign down, you have to continue to file those semi-annual reports. Now, if you're going to raise or spend more than $500, then there are more campaign filing periods. You have to file the January 15th and July 15th, but you also have to file 30 days before the precinct conventions, because that's considered a campaign cycle, right? You have the primary cycle and the general cycle. So the primary cycle is from the time you file to the time you file a campaign treasurer appointment until the precinct convention. So March, somebody give me the date.
13.
March 13th.
Primary will be the 6th of March.
I'm not talking about the primary. Okay. Yeah. We are not primary, so our date goes to the 13th. And then you have to file an 8-day report and a 3-day report. So there's 30, 8, and 3. And you'll have to do that for both cycles. It's on the form you mark primary when it says which election are you talking about. On the form you would mark primary for that time period up through March. And then after that you would file it as the general election. And there's also the 30-day, the 7-day, and the 8-day. 30-day, 8-day, and 3-day, and you have to file those. Now, for the statewide and the state legislature, it's fairly straightforward. You do it all online. It's just you fill out the little boxes of information, but you can also do it in a spreadsheet and upload it. For the county level stuff, I think they're all still doing paper. So you have to fill out the paper by hand, or I'm pretty sure you can print out a spreadsheet that has all the same information in the fields marked. As long as it looks like the form is same information, you can file that as well. And then the third big thing is to get a campaign manager. Now, I did not have a campaign manager on my first campaign when I ran for city council in 2007, and because it was a last minute sort of thing, nobody wanted to run, and I was not about to let this woman run out of post. So I did not get a campaign manager, and it was extremely difficult to keep up with everything, to keep track of all of the appearances and the scheduling, and make those appearances and keep track of everything. Like, it's, if you have to do it yourself, you're gonna have to do it yourself. But if you can find somebody reliable who can reliably do those tasks for you, even if it's just, you know, here, do all of these things, go get my flyers printed, make my flyers, you know, whatever you can delegate off to somebody else, is going to give you more time to do things like radio interviews, debates, show up at candidate meet and greets, because you're going to spend a lot of your time, and if you're working, it's on top of your work schedule. So you're talking about making appearances, spending an hour, two, or three at an event, plus having to figure out how to deal with all of the other stuff that deals with the campaign. And that's where this book comes in handy, because it tells you everything you need to know and do in order to run a campaign. The other book that I did not come across until 2009 is Politics the Wellstone Way. This gives you a little more detail on organizing and how to go into communities that you don't belong to, how to find the people in those communities that can help you get in those communities and speak to them in ways that they understand and not just coming in there and talking down to people, which happens a lot even though you don't mean to, especially if you're not familiar with the culture and the customs, etc. And this was Paul Wellstone's book, and he had I think it was a Hmong community is real big in Minnesota. And so it talks about like going into, you know, refugee type communities and how like if we just walk in there like white Americans, you're not really gonna get very far, or any other American for that matter. but it talks about that, about how to deal with voter lists, how to organize, etc. I highly recommend them as like your Old and New Testament or something like that. Not to be sacrilegious, but you know. So the campaign manager organizes the campaign, schedules engagements with the media and community, organizes voter outreach efforts, coordinates volunteers, which if you have a big enough campaign, you would delegate that to a completely separate person and have a volunteer coordinator, which is gonna be about recruitment and party building and getting elected. Your campaign manager responds to inquiries from media and organizations and helps with messaging and strategy. The one thing, I did have somebody who went with me to all my events. And so when you're there and you're in the candidate's hot seat, you may not pick up on everything, right? So even if you don't have a campaign manager, take somebody who can read a room and feedback to you afterwards, like, hey, when you did this, I saw a bunch of people do this, so let's work on that, or what have you. Embarrassing story, but I went to a neighborhood association and I wore a suit, and but I didn't shave my legs, and I had on a short skirt, and there were people like 3 feet in front of me, and like I noticed these old men like looking at me like there was something wrong with me, and then I was like, oh shoot, like so you know, and so that was I'm gonna come make sure. So I'll segue into the next one and then go back to that story to make a point. While you will get a lot of forum offers and things like that, don't wait for them necessarily. If you know certain organizations are big in your district, then like go to them first and be like, hey, I'm running for this. Mm-hmm. I want to meet with your group, blah, blah, blah. And your campaign manager can do that for you, or you can do it. It doesn't really matter. They will treat you the same. And other public speaking opportunities, like, you know, since we're really heavily in activist communities, I'm sure you have connections and you can, you know, hey, what's coming, you have an idea what's coming up and where you can speak. Coordinate volunteers and party for voter outreach. So block walking, phone bank, literature distribution, event tabling, voter registration, all of these things are pretty standard campaign activities. And then delivering the message to the public. So the thing about going to events and block walking, etc. So the story about the suit. So I borrowed a set of suits from a friend of mine. We were about the same size, and she had to wear them for work. And so I borrowed her suits because I didn't own any. I couldn't afford to buy them. And I wore a suit to every single event, except for Earth Day, because it was hot and it was outside. But every candidate forum I went to, and this is about as casual as you should look at a campaign event. And this is pretty casual. This is pretty business casual. If I take this off, it looks even more casual. Make sure you have a name tag of some sort, and if you're wearing suits, get a magnet. I ruined a couple of really nice suits by putting a pin in it. So I learned this trick. And even if it has a pin on it, you get a little magnet backer, and it works great. Because you, especially if it's a campaign button, you have a campaign button, wear your campaign button. This is my campaign button. It doesn't say anything but my name. And then also wear something green. I would wear a green party button and my campaign button. But you want, I don't dress like this normally. This is my, like, I gotta go to legislature. I gotta go somewhere and do this talk. My normal manner of dress is a little too Austin weird for most people. And even in Austin, I still wear suits to things. Unless I know it's gonna be like for example, I petitioned at King William Festival and I dressed up like Wonder Woman. Well, it's a festival, people dress up, it's a fiesta, anti-fiesta kind of thing. And so it was in fitting and it was attracting attention, although greens around the country were pissed off that I was making us look bad. So you will get a lot of feedback if you do not look professional that you are ruining the party, which I think is ridiculous, but whatever. But it is the case that like these old men who were looking at me because I didn't shave my legs, that people are gonna look at you if you don't look how they expect you to look as a candidate. And people expect candidates to look professional. Even if you're not a professional, you need to put across that appearance that it doesn't matter what I look like, it matters what I'm saying. And if you look like a business professional, they're gonna hear what you're saying and not be distracted by what you look like. And women probably know this already without me even saying it. People of color know this without me even saying it because they have to look that way to be taken seriously. So this is more for the older white men who don't like to wear suits. But, you know, it's, you want people to see you as serious, if you're serious about running. Don't wear flip-flops. Don't wear shorts unless it's like an outside event and there are like, you know, classy looking shorts, not cutoffs or something. What was that?
I said, I like it. Cutoffs.
Yeah. I actually, I had dreadlocks the first two campaigns I ran, and no one noticed until, because the way that I could put them back, like, people didn't, weren't necessarily behind me, and so even on TV, the way the TV lights were, I just looked like I had like curly hair or something. And I went to an event, put it up in a ponytail, and then you could not mistake the fact of it. And this one woman at a booth was like, I saw you on TV and you didn't have dreadlocks. I was like, yeah, I did. I just hit them well. And she's like, oh, wow, that's cool. So, you know, it's, you're gonna, if you're not a normal professional looking person, you are gonna attract the people who don't want any professional in office, but you still have, you have to appeal to both crowds, right? It really depends on your constituency. I was going to neighborhood associations where these people who belong to neighborhood associations are typically professionals, right? They expect you to be like them. But then I went to Earth Day and I looked like an Earth Day person, you know? So it's, you've gotta look like your constituencies or at least look neutral enough that your appearance does not detract from your message, because your message is what is most important next to your integrity. Oh, the other thing. So I did not prepare a handout for you. Thankfully, Laura found our old FAQ and printed that, so you have that. When I was thinking about preparing for this, I realized that for the most part, my preparation for my campaigns was doing Green Party work. I knew what the issues were globally as far as, you know, our platform and all of that, but I had also been doing a lot of work locally. I had gone to like everybody's everything, and I knew what everybody's issues were, so that by the time I ran for office, I had already been doing this for 7 years. So that when I got up to speak, I just spoke. I did not have written statements. I did not prepare, really, other than finding out who I was going to speak in front of and what they were interested in. Because that is what people want to know. They don't care what your little pet project is. They don't care about lunar solar power. They care about the fact that there's a drainage issue, or the streets are crap, or the school's got a problem, or whatever, you know, issue is relevant to the election that you're running. The other thing I found was people wanted to ask me about stuff that had nothing to do with city council, right? They wanted to know my stance on abortion. And honestly, I didn't want to answer their questions because it was a trap. They were trying to, you know, trap me into, like, revealing that I was a horrible person or whatever. And so I would just redirect them into issues. I'd be like, well, that's really not relevant to the city council. I wouldn't be able to do anything, even if I was elected, about abortion. But I can do something about these things. So let's talk about these things. That was helpful. And so preparedness is about knowing, doing your homework, right? If you've done your homework, you know your district, you know what the issues are, then preparation is pretty simple and straightforward. You can just extemporaneously get up and talk. If you're afraid to get up in here and talk in front of people, which, trust me, I had a terrible time with it, go to Toastmasters. It does cost a little bit of money. It's not a lot. You can go to one for free, and honestly, I only went to one, and it was the most educational hour I've spent in speaking. Don't say ah. Try to get those things out of your speaking, because it really makes a difference. Now that I try not to do that, when, for example, when Obama speaks, he does that a lot, and I can't listen to him. It drives me insane. I'm just like, just stop using filler words. But Toastmasters is good for learning how to do extemporaneous speaking, how to just get up and feel less nervous and talking in the crowd. That is what they do. They teach people how to speak in public. Don't say I'm out of practice.
One more.
I'm trying to think of, like, what else to tell you. No, that's it. Oh, yes. If you don't know an answer to a question, what is the correct response?
I don't know.
Exactly.
That's a great question. No one has asked me that yet, but I'd like to know the answer too. Let me do a little homework. Let me get your contact info, and I'll get back to you.
Exactly. So when I ran my first campaign, when I was doing Green Party stuff, if I didn't know an answer, I would tell them that, and I would get back to them. So when I ran my campaign, I did the same exact thing, and I was amazed. So many people came up to me and were like, I'm so appreciative that you told the truth, that you didn't have the answer, and you said you didn't have the answer, and you were willing to admit that you didn't know something. That got me a significant amount of votes, okay? Because my opponent would just say whatever bullshit she was trained to say. And you know how when you're listening to an interview and somebody asks a question and then they say something that's completely irrelevant? Well, that's what they're trained to do, is, like, if they don't know, redirect to something you do know. People hate that. People hate it. There may be people who still get sucked into it, but they still vote for the duopoly, so you're not trying to appeal to them. The people who you want to get their votes will appreciate your honesty and your willingness to learn something that you don't know. And I've had that same conversation. Don mentioned, you know, I don't know the answer to that, but if you give me your information, I'll go do some research and get back to you. Another way to approach it is to say, well, I'm not really familiar with that subject. Can you fill me in? And usually they know a lot because they're asking you. And so they can give you a lot of information. And sometimes you can answer based on that. Or sometimes you'd be like, well, you know, I'll go look into that deeper and let you know. And that is probably, I should be at the top of the list of things to do, is to always be honest and tell people what you really know and what you really think, except, let me caveat that, I change the way I speak when I speak in public. I try my best never to swear, even though I swear a lot. I try my best to speak respectfully and in common English. I try not to use proprietary language. Progressives are horrible about using, especially educated white people, are horrible about using words that they know, but the average person has no idea what you're talking about. So you have to speak in a, we had a candidate who ran for Supreme Court Justice, Ben Levy, who got like 10% of the vote in 2002. Both of those years, Jack Nottingham. Jack Nottingham ran for office in Bexar County, and he used to work for the DOD writing manuals for people who were going to be using nuclear arms, okay? And the military had a sixth grade reading level requirement. Everything is written in sixth grade English. So campaigning, he did the same thing. And he taught us that too as well. It's like, if you make it so that a sixth grader can understand it, even a kindergartner, if you can get a young child to understand what you're talking about, then you're using the right words and you're gonna communicate to a broader audience. Because most adults don't wanna admit that they don't know what you're talking about and they don't wanna ask you what you're talking about. And unless you're really good at reading tells, or they're not really good at hiding their tells, you won't know that people don't know what you're talking about. They will be like, oh yeah, you know, and agree with you, and they won't have a clue. So do your best to try to reword things. Speak, if you don't know, I'm horrible at this. I do not know how to speak in middle school English. I taught high school because of that. And so I would have to go to people who, it's not that they were uneducated, they just were able to like listen to what I was saying and tell me, okay, I don't know that word, or people are not going to know what you're talking about. So we need to work on your messaging. So when you're working on your messaging, think about how you would communicate this to a child. And if you can do that successfully, you will be able to reach the majority of your adult audience, because they won't be confused by your proprietary language and your liberal elitist BS, right? And people don't like to be talked down to. I mean, I'm sure nobody in here likes to be talked down to. And you may not think that you're talking down to them, but if you're using proprietary language and big words, people are gonna feel like you're talking down to them. So, you know, keep it simple, period. Yeah, anybody got questions? Yeah, Janice?
Yeah, I loved your example about redirecting the abortion question.
Uh-huh.
And I just got an idea from what you said, and maybe you can confirm if this is useful. If anybody asks you a question that might even be a threatening or invitation type question to get you in trouble, it seems to me, would you recommend treating them as if they ask you a legitimate question that you will answer back, as if they're a middle schooler and you can say anything you want? I think your segue into that was really cool, and I'm going to copy that idea, but just answer like, you know, that won't really, you know, city council doesn't address that, and, you know, maybe have a chance to say a positive word or two about something you want.
Yeah, I mean, redirection is great when people are being hostile, when they're being intentionally antagonistic, whatever. And, you know, the other people in the room aren't going to be happy about it either. I saw this happen at forums where, like, somebody would get up and get all, like, haughty and hostile towards the candidates, and the rest of the room would just be like, you know? So it's not just you, it's everybody doesn't like it. And so when you can redirect, always redirect, but not redirect to get out of answering a question that's legitimate, right? But if they're heckling, what's the rule, don't engage hecklers, which is really hard. But, you know, you want to keep it on, that's where your three main talking points come into play. Because if they're like trying to get you off on some, piss you off, get you to say something, be like, well, that's not really what this campaign's about. This campaign's about this. Yeah, absolutely.
What about if they ask a legitimate question that you would have influence over, but it's not something necessarily that your constituents would like? For example, as Greens in Texas, there's a lot of conservatives that wouldn't be happy with abortion or things like that.
Okay, here's a good example. Are y'all familiar with the Cornerstone Church in San Antonio? It's John Hagee's Christian Zionist. Yeah. Anyway, they do a God and Country event every election, and they invite every single candidate. And they introduce you so that your face and your name is on TV and radio, whatever, which is why we went. And then they do this, they have somebody goes up there and does this horrible, like, thing. And the one I went to was maligning the word social justice and talking about, I mean, they were maligning the Methodists. They had the symbol for the Methodists up there. And, you know, they were just like, if you're not against abortion, then don't vote for them, right? And so my mom went with me because she used to go to that church, and she was like, "Why? What are you going to say?" And I was like, "Well, it's simple. Our stance on abortion is that we need to look at why people are having abortions and reduce the need for abortions, so then it's not even an issue, right? So you can answer the abortion question in a way that nobody can argue with you, right? It's like, why are women having abortions? Well, we know, because they're not educated properly and they don't have access to medical level planning, family planning. They don't have access to contraception. You know, there's legitimate reasons that even my mother, who is anti-abortion, would support, right? She supports free access to contraception. She supports sex education. She supports education of women equal to or greater than men. So you can get conservatives on your side if you actually read the platform and look at how it's worded, because the platform actually talks about abortion in those terms. That let's reduce the need for it, and it's a medical thing, right? Let's put the abortion question under doctors and let doctors deal with that, but let's deal with the societal problems that lead women to believe, and accurately so, that abortion is the only answer for them to not have a screwed up life, right? So let's address that. And I've successfully done that with a lot of really religious conservative people. And they're like, "Oh, well, I just thought you were a baby killer." Well, no, I really want to reduce, because personally I've had an abortion. I don't say that when I'm campaigning unless it's a very specific crowd. But, like, I wish I hadn't had to go through that process, right? So, you know, it's all about finding the nuance. If you know your audience is going to be against something that you support, find a way to shift the message so that they'll support why you support it, right? Even if they don't agree with you, they at least understand why you're doing it. And I've gotten votes from people who didn't agree with me on some things, but they agreed with me on the things that mattered more. Dawn and then Alex?
No, about 2 minutes left.
Okay, Alex?
I mean, how do you not just say different? You know, there are a lot of problems with Bernie, but I do think one of his appeals was he said, like, he was not antagonistic about it, but he did say the same thing to every audience. And, you know, he did speak to almost every college.
Liberty University.
And he did focus on the areas of agreement, but he was very straightforward about there are, you know, I'm a socialist, you know, these are, you know, he did not try to hide what he believes and who he was. I think, I don't know where you draw that line, but I think people, I mean, I think at least I would say a lot of conservatives respect Bernie to an extent, because, like, what people are very tired of now is people who believe in nothing and will not stand up for anything. I mean, you don't have to be antagonistic to someone, but I think you also have to be, I mean, if you're consistent and honest and you're the same person wherever you go. But I mean, I've never run for office, so I don't know where to draw that line.
Yeah, the consistency and the honesty, honestly, I was pretty consistent in my message. that's the three point. Your messaging, you need to develop first off, right? So once you have your messaging, you stay on your message as much as possible. There's going to be stuff that's outside of your message, and you can choose how to deal with it. It's more about, like, nuancing, right? Like, if you know that you want to appeal to this certain crowd and they understand these words to mean something that you don't mean, right? Like in this crowd of religious people who were all just told that social justice is an evil thing, right? Okay, now I can't use that word social justice and have them hear me, right? So it just depends on whether or not you want to be like, I'm going to be true to myself and I'm going to use my words that I am attached to because they have meaning for me, then you're going to lose votes, period. But if you can take the idea behind those words and communicate it in language that antagonists would understand, then, or your opposition would understand, then you're going to do several things. You're going to broaden your audience. You're going to broaden the spreading of your ideas. And because that's what I was saying about proprietary language. Socialists, by the way, no offense, but I have run into more socialists who are attached to their ideological words than they are about communicating the ideas behind the words. And so it's just a matter of whether you want to be the bull in the China shop and just stick to your words and like only have the people who like know what you're talking about on your side, or whether you want to reach out. See, because when I was running for city council, it was a nonpartisan race, and so, but everybody knew I was green. And so but people didn't know what that meant. So, I was able to reword things so that I had Reform Party people give me money. I had Constitution Party people give me money. I had Republicans vote for me. I had Republicans campaign for me. You know, so because it was about what I wanted to do once I got elected. And because I worded it in neutral terms that were not loaded, I tried to stay away from loaded terms. Things that are used to divide the electorate, I avoided those as much as possible. That was my personal way of doing things, right? But I found it to be really effective for getting a broader base of support, as opposed to only ideologues who like, oh yeah, that's what I believe, so I'm gonna vote for you. I was trying to win. I was trying to get the vast majority of people who didn't have a clue what Green Party values really were talking about. You could spout off the 10 key values and they're like glazed over, right? But if I started talking about how the system in the city council district in the city was designed to perpetuate wealthy people getting elected, and describe that process, which was really about elitism and classism and stuff like that. But I avoided the word classism completely. But I was talking about classism, but I was talking about it in real life ways that people live with on a day-to-day basis, and not using some Marxist ideology. Kevin and Gary, and I know we're out of time, but can we go a little bit?
We can go a little bit more.
Okay.
I wanted to ask, you know, one of the things, there's the issues and all that, but people are looking at candidates for other things too. I mean, and in particular, how do you get across, or how do you think you get across the idea to the public that you're actually on their side, in the sense that, you know, you can't anticipate the future, nobody can, but when things come up, are you going to be on their side, or are you going to be on, you know, the special interest side, or whatever? How do you get that kind of idea across?
So how do you get the idea across that you're not just saying shit, that you're actually gonna show up and be there, right? That's this is a little more complicated. In my case, I had 7 years of history, right? People knew, I had people who vouched for me at every single event I went to that were part of that community. because they had seen me putting my mouth and putting my actions where my words were. So that makes a huge difference. And just your, some people just pick up on it, right? They know if you're being honest, they know if you're being shady, they know if you're just spouting off some ideology that is mostly meaningless to their lives on a real day-to-day kind of basis. And so it really comes down to them not talking down to people, using common language, and then doing things in the community. Like, even if it's small things, like, so I moved to Austin a few years ago. Not many people know me, but they all know my roommate. And so as soon as I tell them I live with her, I'm good. You know, my street cred just tripled, quadrupled, whatever. And, or went from 0 to 100. And so it's really about who you know. If you don't have a lot of connections, then you've got to build them. You know, it's hard if you're like new to a community to get that sort of reputation. But if you've got a reputation, build off of it. If you don't have a reputation, find those people in the community that have some legitimacy and work with them, work on their projects. Don't go in there and tell them what to do. Go in there and be like, how can I help you do what you need to do? And when the community sees you doing the manual labor, emotional labor, etc., then they're going to take you more seriously. And it doesn't have to be a big deal. It could just be like, you know, I don't know what to do up in North Texas, but like if you're in Houston, you're like, go down to any of the groups that are working on Harvey relief stuff and spend a few hours doing volunteer work. You know, it's as simple as that. Like in San Antonio, we had, you know, the women who used to work at Levi's were always doing something. And even if it was just serving people food at an event for them so that they could do something else, right? It's like, it's switching the roles. You've got an organization of all women of color who most of them don't speak English, and you show up and you do the manual labor for them. That will give you that credibility that you're talking about. Who's next? Gary?
Yeah. I was really fortunate to have a really great campaign manager, Robert Caldwell. Mm-hmm. He's with the Collin County Greens. He's also with Solidarity and System Change, not Climate Change. I couldn't have done it by myself because I had a full-time job and also my other obligations. So, and he had prior campaign experience. So look for, you know, a fellow organizer, a fellow activist who, you know, it's not just words, but actually has been doing the work for years. And so that was really great. I was really fortunate with my treasurer. She was very good. She worked in finance. That helped a lot. I mean, I was a humanities major, not a math major, so it would have been a disaster if I had tried to do my treasury. And also, you need a great artist, and Alexandra was my artist. She made this for my campaign, and we were able to get signage put out. And then also she designed my car with our positions.
That was so useful.
It was so useful. The only thing that was really difficult was we just didn't have enough people power to get out there and go to the polling. But we did canvassing. We went door to door, and then we went to the polling stations for early voting and for the day of the election. But again, we just didn't have enough folks to do that. And also the Dems didn't run anyone against Pete Sessions, and they were telling people to vote straight ticket.
Yeah.
So when we talked with folks, they didn't realize there wasn't a Democrat running against Pete Sessions. So when they heard we were running, they said, most of them said we were voting.
Yeah, and thank you for bringing up the literature stuff. I actually brought a bag of buttons. Please do not take them. They're one of a kind. But they're from all over the country, and you can see really bad designs and really good designs. And the same thing with campaign literature. I'm sure y'all have all gotten a crap load of campaign literature from other campaigns. look at what appeals to you and what turns you off, and make sure that you have a good graphic design for your campaign,
yes,
because it makes a huge difference. My signs were this font, a big black sign with the word cat vote, cat, and then the date. And like people noticed them. They were so unique, right? And so now you're starting to see more unique signs. I wish I had brought one I had done for Ashley Gordon in Travis County. I mean, they stood out. Even just, they were green and yellow, but they were so unusual compared to most of them. They're like red, white, and blue, and trying to confuse people to whether they're Republican or Democrat, you know, and they're like lame. And but they're expensive to print multiple colors. Try to do one color, which is why I did black on a white canvas. The white wasn't actually a color, it was just the sign. You've got green and white, you know, keep its sign simple. Your literature needs to have a lot of white space, you know, it can't be text heavy. You know, you've got to make it so that people, you know, they've got 5 seconds, they're looking at something to see whether or not they want to read it. Graphic design is super, super important. And you have, if you're going to campaign at all, you need swag of some nature. I had buttons and literature and signs, and that was it. And I still have a few signs. I've used them over and over again. And, you know, if you design them like I did, you can modify them easily. Somebody else have a question? Joy, do you have any?
Corey? I did have something I wanted to mention in the line of what Aaron was going at with people power and something that was mentioned earlier today. When I was in Corpus, one of the things that I did was I was working as a elections technician, so I was doing that on election day and during the early voting period, making sure the machines were running properly. But that encouraged me to, when I was starting Normal Corpus, to get out and talk to people, was to become a voter registrar. And that's something that's, I think, an extremely important and easy thing to do, to be able to get out the vote about, or information about campaigns that you're working on, whether it's yours or somebody else's, get out information about the Green Party, is going and registering voters, because it's not something, even with the, systems being developed in such a way that it's now easier to stay registered and get your driver's license and things like that, it's still not automatic, and this is something that you can do proactively to get more voters out and get more information out and available to people, and get more people that want to work for your campaign.
Yeah, absolutely. And just to repeat the key points for the live stream, in case I couldn't hear you, that and actually, that was, so Corey brought up becoming a voter, deputy voter, it's called a VDR, voter deputy registrar.
Yes.
Yeah.
So there's two voter registration cards. There's these that you fill out yourself and mail in for free, or there's these that a voter deputy registrar, it's the same up to here, and then it has this special part at the bottom. And this is really important if you're running a campaign, that for almost everybody who's working on your campaign needs to be a deputized voter registrar, because this can disappear, okay? And they will never get their voter card, and they'll be like, well, I sent in a card, but, you know, they have no proof that they sent it in, and there's no recourse. This, however, you give them this bottom part, it tears off, and it has your voter registrar's number on it, and it has the date that you signed up, and they can take this receipt and vote with it, okay? That is why these are so important. One, it registers them almost, more immediately, and because it takes effect 30 days after. And then if they never get their card, and they keep this, they can go vote. So, and plus also you can take these back. These, you cannot have them fill this out and take it back. It is a felony. Don't do it, okay? But these, you have to take them back. So this is the best thing to do if you're on a campaign. Thank you, Corey, for mentioning it. You really need to be out in the community. You know, the Dems and the Republicans, when they do their block walking, they target people based on how they vote. That means that they don't do apartment complexes. They don't do non-registered voters. Now, they do voting drives, etc., but they don't go to the doors of people who aren't registered to vote. What I did, because I couldn't afford the list and making them by hand was too much pain in the neck, I went to every single door in my neighborhood and knocked on every single door. And people who weren't registered, I registered them if they wanted to, and if they were able to and they wanted to. But I talked to people who had never been talked to by a campaign ever in their lives, and they wanted to vote. And so this is like the best thing to do. And I will close with one brief little story about a state representative that got elected in my district. And he was an underdog. He was not known at all. And he block walked the entire district 3 times. Now, granted, he used block walk lists, okay? And he went to like regular voters. But he won that election, and that was how he did it. People were like, you showed up at my house 3 times during the campaign, and I got to talk to you, and when you came back, I got to ask you questions, because it's that repeated interface, right? And not everybody's gonna go to your neighborhood association meeting. Most of the neighborhood doesn't like the HOA anyway. You know, so you really, and you're not going to necessarily get media attention. So you have to do what you can. And this is the best direct way, is just to start walking neighborhoods and apartment complexes especially. No one ever campaigns at apartment complexes because they move too often. You know, a lot of them 6-month leases, people don't even bother to register to vote. And so, you know, if you go hit the apartment complexes month and a half before the election, those people probably aren't going to move, and you can register them, and you know, and they will never have been approached before, not with mailers, not with humans. So if you're going to run a campaign, go out and do the things that the other people don't do.
So I just wanted to say, like, there are so many opportunities that you can be capitalizing on before the actual opportunity to become registered or whatever. You need to already be showing up in your community. Go to like the fair fairs or any sort of like board that you can do, any sort of local action that you can do that. All those are recorded on camera, okay? Those are logged. They can search you. You can then get that video again and use it as campaign material. Like, and have someone show up with you when you go to make that speech to actually take a video of that speech. Capture your things and then collect that data so that you can then use it to make videos later. Like, and then they have, like, you can Google these things and see, this is every single time they showed up at a city council meeting. This is every single time they spoke at a city council meeting on these particular issues and having the important particular issues for this particular community, particular area. Like, and that gets noticed, right? That becomes viral. Like, I mean, we can't underestimate the importance of, like, the technology that we have available. And one of the only good things that we have is the fact that all the city council meetings, all of this, it's all on video, okay? You can have multiple people coming, also taking their own kind of video as well. Keep that, tag it, whatever you need to do to be able to use campaign materials later, and every single person can see, they showed up here, they showed up here, they showed up here, they showed up here, and you're actually being present in your community and speaking on important issues. And then, you know, that counts. When you speak, when you do certain things, you know, every time you make a letter to the editor or whatever, those can also be collected. And then you can see, these are all the different things that I did for my community. You know, as well as like getting actual things done, like working on a project at the Fair Affairs and getting that accomplished, or, you know, working on get a tenants union accomplished, you know, working on these different kinds of things so that, like, this is an accomplishment that I did, not as a candidate, but as a person in my community, representing my community as something that I wanted to do regularly. And now here's a reason why you should vote for me, because I've been here all the time and you have evidence. You know, people know your name. Like, they know exactly how to say it. The people who are on the councils know you. The people that also show up at the councils also know you. And you have some cred within the community. Because if you don't have cred within the community, like, you know, what does it matter? Like, there, I mean, maybe you have a name that works, you know? But for the most part, if someone actually knows who you are, you know, just be like, Gary. People knew who Gary was. Like, and we had people come in who were, okay, I will now work for you, even though they weren't Greens. And they still have good relationships with us months on, that we can still go back and then, you know, and work together on different issues. Because we made those relationships at the time. We made them before, during, and after. And we kept those relationships going for the next opportunity. And Gary may be run, or other people may be run, but it establishes, like, a community of people working together for campaigns that lasts. You know, and you actually get something accomplished outside of just the electoral season.
Great, thank you, Austin. Does anybody have any quick last minute questions? Otherwise, I'm going to go.
Really quick, if there's a short answer for it. You worked really hard over the past legislative session on the bill to get rid of the straight ticket voting.
Mm-hmm.
What is the current legal status of that?
And that's a topic for another workshop.
Just wondering if there was a short answer.
There's no short answer, and we're going to talk about that in a little bit.
Okay.
So, all right. So feel free to ask me questions later. Thanks for those who contributed. And